Hello friends, now in this session we are going to discuss about the Employees State Insurance Act and rules. So in the previous section we have discussed about the Workmen Compensation Act and rule. Now we are discussing about the Employee State Insurance Act and their rules. So let us first discuss what exactly the Employee State Insurance Act 1948. So this act, that is number 34, 1948, came into force from 31st March 1948. And then it is modified and amended. So an act to provide for certain benefits to employees in case of sickness, maternity, and employment injury, and to make provisions for certain other matters in relation thereto. So this act is especially focused on the different benefits or the contributions and other provisions. So this is modified in 1950, 1956, 1957, and then amended in 1951, 66, 70, 75, 84, and 89. So this covers 8 chapters, 100 sections, and 2 schedules. And from the safety officer's point of view, from the industrial point of view, the main or the important chapters are the contributions and the benefits. That is chapter number 4 and 5. Now in the section 1, that is preliminary part, this act applies to the whole of India and to all other factories other than the seasonal factories. So it is applicable to all factories except seasonal factories. It can be applied to establishment, industrial, commercial, agricultural, or otherwise with 6 months' notice. Once the act applies, it shall continue even if the number of employees falls below the limit or the manufacturing process or with or without power cases. So that doesn't matter if the employee number is reduces after declaring or sanctioning the act. This is under Employee State Insurance Act. Then the section 2 defines the different definitions or the terminologies which involves under this act, like appropriate, government, confinement, contribution, corporation, dependent, etc. So there are various definitions under this section 2. Contribution means the sum of money payable to the ESI corporation by the principal employer in respect of an employee and an amount payable by or on behalf of the employee. So there are important definitions like contribution is there. So contribution means the sum of money payable to the ESI corporation by the principal employer. So that contribution, that is reference chapter 4. So we will discuss the details in the chapter 4. Then dependent includes many relatives as prescribed by the section 2 and with reference to 6A. Normally, the dependent means the relatives of a deceased insured person, that is a widow, a legitimate or adopted son who has not attained the age of 25 years, or an unmarried legitimate or adopted daughter, or a widow mother, if wholly dependent on the earnings of the insured person at the time of his death, a legitimate or adopted son or daughter who has attained the age of 25 and who is infirm. And likewise, there are different parameters and the conditions where we can define the dependent. So to get the benefit of this ESI Act and whatever the compensation amount, we must check the dependent definition. Then employment injury means an injury to employee caused by accident or occupational disease arising out of and in course of his employment. Whether the accident or a disease takes place within or outside India. Employees include direct, contract or hired person at main factory or establishment or its department, branch or a place for sale or purchase, and also an apprentice. So not under the Apprentice Act 1961, his wage limit be prescribed by the central government. So the employee may be on roll, that may be on contract, that may be a hired person, whatever it may be. If it is defined as an employee, then this ESI is applicable for him or her. Then family is defined under the section 2 of 11. The family means all or any of the following relatives, like a spouse, a minor legitimate, or a child who is infirmed by reason of any physical or mental abnormalities or injury and is wholly dependent on the earnings of the insured person. Then dependent parents, in case the insured person is unmarried and his or her parents are not alive, a minor brother or a sister wholly dependent upon the earnings of the insured persons. So this is a family which is defined under this section 2 and subsection 11. Then different definitions are also there, like factory, then immediate employer, insurable employment, insured person, managing agent, miscarriage, permanent partial disablement. Now the permanent partial disablement, we have already discussed in the Workmen Compensation Act. I am going to repeat it again as it is important part. Permanent partial disablement means such disablement of permanent nature as reduces the earning capacity of an employee in every employment which he was capable of undertaking at the time of accident, resulting in the disablement. So it is a permanent but partial disablement. So all the injuries which are covered under this permanent partial disablement are mentioned in part 2 of the second schedule. Then permanent total disablement means such disablement of a permanent nature as incapacitates an employee for all works which he was capable of performing at the time of accident, resulting in such disablements. So it is a permanent but total disablement. So it is 100%. And all these injuries are covered under part 1 of the second schedule, or from combination of injuries in part 2 thereof. Then temporary disablement means a condition which requires a medical treatment and make the employee temporarily incapable of doing the work which he was doing prior to the time of injury. So if finger cut is there, if wound is there, if something is happened with that body part, and if there is a need of medical treatment, then that is called as temporary disablement. Then wages, that includes all remuneration except contribution to any pensions, pension fund or provident fund, or under this act, traveling allowance, gratuity and special expenses. Then with reference to section 19, that is corporation's power for health measures. The corporation may, in addition to the scheme of benefits, promotes measures for the improvement of health and welfare, rehabilitations and re-employment of insured persons from the funds of the corporations. So corporation is going to give the support for the health and health benefits. So this is mentioned under Section 19. Then Section 28 related to the purposes of the ESI fund. So the payment of benefits and the medical treatment to insured persons and their families. That is ESI funding. So expenditure of hospitals, dispensaries, medical and ancillary services for the insured persons and their families are covered under this ESI funding. Contribution to state government, local authority, or any private body or individual towards cost of medical treatment to insured persons and their families, including cost of building and equipments. So all these contributions, expenditures are covered under this ESI funding. So all these are the different purposes of this ESI fund. Then expenditure for the employment or the improvement of health, welfare, rehabilitation and re-employment of insured or injured person. So regarding the health aspects, welfare facilities or re-employment and rehabilitations, whatever the expenditures are there, that can be governed by the ESI fund. Payment of fees, salaries, allowances of the members, officers and staff. Payment of cost of auditing accounts, courts set up under the act, contract and cost of any legal or court proceedings. So all these things are covered under this Employee State Insurance Act funding. Then the important chapter is contributions. So this chapter covers section 38 to 41-1. That is, there are two types of contributions, like employer's contribution and employee's contribution. So rates may be prescribed by the central government and the payment becomes due on the last day of the wage period. So the interest 12% per annum or more for the late payments. Then it is recoverable as an arrears of land revenue. The principal employer shall pay both the contributions and can recover from the employees or their immediate employer. So that is depend on the case. But the principal employer or the immediate employer has to pay this contribution. Then register of employees, contributions necessary and returns are also required under this contribution chapter. Then ESI inspectors have powers to visit the factories, establishments, etc. and to ask any principal or immediate employer to furnish necessary information, account books, records, etc. regarding the employment of persons, payment of wages, etc. and can make copies also for the purpose of this act. So all the documents should be ready and all these documents can be cross-verified by the ESI inspector anytime. Why it is necessary? To avoid the delay in the payment to the injured person or the insured persons. Then chapter 5 is related to the benefits. That is from section 46 to 73-1. So insured persons, their dependents or other persons mentioned can get following benefits under this act. So there are various definite benefits mentioned under this chapter 5. Though they can get similar benefits available under the service conditions, customary concessions, sickness leave, motor accidents claims under the Motor Vehicle Act, and damages or compensation for injuries due to the negligence of the employer. So let us look at what exactly the benefits are mentioned under this chapter 5. Sickness benefit. That is periodical payments for sickness certified by a doctor. Eligibility rates and conditions may be prescribed by the central government. So if you are not comfortable, if you are not fit, And if the doctor is certified that he is sick, then whatever the periodical payments are required, that is, can be absorbed through this sickness benefits. Then maternity benefit. So the periodical payments to an insured woman in case of confinement, miscarriage, sickness due to the pregnancy, premature birth, etc. on medical certificate. Then eligibility rates, period and conditions may be prescribed by the central government. So the woman can get the benefits of these different aspects, which is directly related to the maternity. So that may be a confinement, that may be a miscarriage, that may be a sickness due to the pregnancy, premature birth, etc. Then disablement benefit. So the periodical payment to an insured person for disablement due to temporary injury and certified by a doctor. So certificate by the doctor is necessary to have the authentic clarity about this injury, and then only they can give the benefits. For temporary disablement of more than 3 days, excluding the day of accident, and for permanent disablement, total or partial, this benefit is available at the rate, period and conditions prescribed by the central government. So the condition is for the temporary disablement, more than 3 days is required. And for the permanent disablement, that may be total or partial, the benefits can be given as per the central government norms. An accident shall be presumed as an arisen in course of employment in the absence of evidence to the contrary. Benefit is available for accident happening while acting in breach of regulations or while traveling in employer's transport or while meeting emergency and acting for the employer's trade for business. Then the fourth benefit is dependents benefit. So the periodical payment to the dependents on insured person who dies due to the employment injury. So dependents benefit is for the fatality cases only. The rates, period and conditions are prescribed by the central government. Then medical benefit, payment or for medical, surgical or obstetric treatment for an attendance on insured person. So it is given by the state government or the corporations. Then funeral expenses. So in case of fatality, in case of death, payment to the family members or any other persons who actually incurs the expenditure on the funeral of the deceased insured persons. So these are the main ESI benefits, that is sickness, maternity, disablement, dependents, medical and funeral. The claim should be made within 3 months of the death of the insured persons. Occupational disease as an employment injury, contracting of any disease mentioned in the third schedule and in its part A without any period of the employment, part B for working more than 6 months in the employment, and part C is for working such period as the corporation specified. So it is like a part A, B, C, D of the list of occupational diseases under the Workmen Compensation Act. The right to receive any payment of any benefit is not transferable or assignable. So the disablement benefit can't be committed for a lump sum amount. Sickness or disablement benefit for temporary disablement can't be availed if the employee works on that day or remains on leave or on a paid holiday or on strike. So we have to check the conditions first, and then only we can give the idea regarding these benefits and the calculations or the amounts. Recipient of sickness or disablement benefit will observe the conditions to to remain under medical treatment at a place provided under this act, to carry out the medical instructions, not to leave the area, to allow himself for medical examinations, and not to do anything which may retard chances of recovery. An insured person can't get for the same period both sickness and maternity benefit, both sickness and temporary disablement benefit, both maternity and temporary disablement benefit. So when a person is entitled to more than one such benefit, he has to choose any one benefit. So it is the specific case that an insured person can't get for the same period both the benefits, like case A, case B, and case C. So the person has to decide that. The corporation has right to recover where a principal employer fails or neglects to pay any contribution, or for excessive sickness arise due to insanitary working conditions or not observing any health regulations. If any person receives any benefits unlawfully, he shall be liable to repay to the corporation that amount. So if there is a illegal receives the amount, then the person should repay that amount to the corporation. If any person dies, any cash benefits payable to him shall be paid to his nominees or representatives up to and including the day of his death. No employer can reduce wages or benefits payable by him under service conditions because of the benefits conferred by this act. No employer can dismiss or punish employee during period of sickness, maternity, temporary disablement, or certified illness, etc. Notice of dismissal, discharge, or reduction during such period shall be invalid or inoperative. A person who misuses these benefits given under this act will be disentitled by the central government after giving him an opportunity of being heard. And then there are different sections that is called as miscellaneous as a chapter, that is 87 to 100. So 100 sections are there in this act. The government has power of exemptions. Rule-making power lies with the central as well as the state government, and the corporation has power to make regulations. So for their subjects, see section 95 to 97, which is related to the power to make regulations. Thank you.